So maybe I'm wrong about this, but I've tried my best to look into the lore and understand where this all came from, where it began, and how it matters. So I think, in order to clearly illustrate to you what I believe identifies the Doctor, I'm going to take 13 reasons why the Doctor is the Doctor. Sound good? Well, too bad. Even if it doesn't sound good, I'm about to do it. Number one. Something iconic that I think started as early as William Hartnell is that the Doctor is very much a caretaker. What does that mean? It means he's equal parts teacher as he is wise person. Wise man, wise woman. The Doctor, to me, whoever they may be, needs to come across as if they give a damn about what they're doing and who they're doing it for. But they also need to come across as a little bit alien, so to speak. I guess the best way to describe it is your old grandpa. That, I'm sure a lot of us have had that kind of grandpa. That's like, he's off-putish. He's not totally lovey-dovey. He's not totally willing to hang out with you all the time. He's not totally hip with all the new fashion lingo. He's a little bit quirky. He's a little bit old-fashioned a little bit. And he comes off as stern and a little bit angry or cranky, but you still love him because you know he's caring in his own way. And I think that's what matters to the Doctor. Not the cranky bit, not the grandpa bit, but more specifically, caring in their own way. It doesn't matter which Doctor it is, all of them, to my extent, cared in their own way. And it was clear that they cared. That's what matters to me. Which brings us to number two. I mentioned a little bit alien. This might be better suited to Matt Smith, you might think, but hear me out. From what I understand of John Pertwee is arguably kind of alien in his portrayal of the Doctor. Less so like William Hartnell, who was sort of a grandpa-esque character. John Pertwee brought a little bit of quirkiness to the Doctor, something that would stick for a long time. He had his quirks, he had his way of explaining things that was just a little bit off. Like, you think maybe the way he's explaining things isn't the best. Mixed with a little bit of arrogance, like, he doesn't really need to explain it to you, but he's going to try anyway. That's important. Most, if not all, Doctors to me have a little bit of arrogance that shines through in the way that they explain things. Because once you have all that knowledge in your mind, how exactly do you explain it to someone who has none of that knowledge? If you're being a caretaker and a teacher, a mentor of sports, that's fine, but how do you do it without coming across just a little bit alien, just a little bit confusing? Number three. A man with a job to do. Or a woman with a job to do. Number three, of course. Who can forget? Though his name slips my mind right at this moment. The actor of Doctor Number Three was very well known for many things that he would teach to children. He would do children's programs all the time. One of his most famous ones, to my knowledge, about British culture is that he would to Scarecrow. I forget the name of the program, but it was a very cute program about a scarecrow learning to be a person, but he kind of acted like a child, and that's useful. But what did he bring to the doctor? What aspect am I referring to that makes him the doctor? Well, take charge attitude. Right, I just realized I actually referred to Patrick Troughton as John Pertwee, and John Pertwee is actually the real second or third Doctor, whereas Patrick Troughton was in fact the second Doctor. Sorry about that, but let's get back to it. The take charge attitude. If anything, and if nothing else, John Pertwee brought a take-charge attitude, as well as a few other things, such as, to my knowledge, K-9, but I might be wrong there, and, of course, Bessie into the fray. In Pertwee's era, he was very much so he had a job to do. He worked with the unit. He was stranded on Earth. There wasn't much more he could do. So the Doctor became very much a take-charge sort of character. Why does that matter? Because a Doctor, no matter who they are, or who's portraying them, needs to be able to take charge. They need to be a leader. Be it charismatically, or just by sheer force of will. It's important, because without it, what is there? Nothing would get done. The Doctor wouldn't be able to save the day if people didn't listen to them. So, that's an aspect I believe is necessary. Next up, Tom Baker. There are so many things to say about Tom. But I want to focus on one particular aspect. Fashionably different. Now, you might have thought, wouldn't I mention Colin Baker if I was going to talk about fashionably different? Well, no, because Colin Baker's outfit was absolutely atrocious. So we're not going to do that. Tom Baker's outfit is iconic. It matters for a number of things. Another thing that he brought into the fray, but I'm not going to focus on him in particularly, was a catchphrase. But catchphrases are optional. They really are. Tom Baker gave a lot of things, but the thing I'm going to use for the fourth thing that matters in the Doctor is fashion sense. Whatever they wear, it has to be just a little bit quirky. And you might be thinking, hold on. Most of the Doctors wore completely normal things. Yes, most of them did, but then most of their things were also slightly outdated for the era in which they existed. And you might be thinking to yourself, well, that's not entirely that odd. But, trust me. I personally think every Doctor has to have some sort of iconic look. Otherwise, well, it feels like they don't have personality. They got to express their personality through their clothes. And I feel like most Doctors, if not all of them, manage to do that really well. Number 5. The fifth thing that's important to being a Doctor. You might be thinking to yourself, damn, this is a wrong fucking video. And yeah, it's going to be, because I'm going off the cuff, and I'm also really wanting to talk to you about all the things that matter. And I'm a little bit scatterbrained, just like Jodie. Don't know if that's the greatest, but it is what it is. So, number five. What's the fifth thing that needs to be a doctory thing? Well, you've seen this one coming. Peter Davison portrayed the fifth Doctor, and something he brought to the Doctor that stuck and stayed for a long time, and maybe it didn't. Maybe it was always there, but it was very more so enforced in the fifth Doctor, was pacifism. More accurately, technical pacifism. The Doctor doesn't like guns. The Doctor does not use weapons. The Doctor uses a tool that's kind of like a Swiss Army knife, and he uses wit. The Doctor cannot use a gun to get his way. The Doctor cannot use idle threats. The Doctor has to be a puzzle solver that solves problems using charisma, wit, and a little bit of ingenuity. If he doesn't do that, if he breaks off, it gets a little iffy. 11 was my favorite, but even he had a problem with committing genocides. The reasons why this is important, why the whole pacifism thing is important, is because you'll notice that, for New Who at least, an ongoing element was the Doctor fucked up. And it scarred him. It scarred him badly. So, I think Peter Davison brought that to the table, and I think that's an important aspect. The Doctor needs to be a technical pacifist. Which brings us to number six. What is the sixth aspect that every Doctor must have? Well, I had to think about this one for a little bit. After all, how do I discuss my least favorite Doctor in any sense without screwing things up? And then it dawned on me. The Doctor's flawed. Okay, I'm just kidding. I'm not gonna be an asshole. I'm sure there's at least one or two people out there who actually like Colin Baker's performance. They love what he did. And I wouldn't blame them, because you know what Sixth Doctor represents to me? He represents the Doctor's dark side. The Doctor is a person. He may be an alien, but he's a person. And no person is without flaw or without dark sides. Bits of them that if they weren't there, they just wouldn't be a complete full person. And the Sixth Doctor represents that. The Doctor needs to be dark. All of them. Every single one of them was dark. Maybe it wasn't always in the foreground, but it was always there. You saw flecks of something deeper, some deeper-seated rage, some deeper-seated issues, and that is important. Every Doctor needs to have a dark side. Number seven. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that this one was portrayed by none other than the greatest, the best, just kidding, I don't know, Sylvester McCoy. I don't know a lot about Sylvester McCoy. It's one of the few Doctors I know nothing about. And I suppose it's hard for me to really define them, because he's the one Doctor I don't know a lot about. But I think something interesting about his character that I can remember from things I've read is that he was kind of manipulative. He was very comical, which is an important aspect, but he was manipulative. For better and for worse. The Doctor needs wit. And I think Sylvester McCoy, from what I understand, showed that a lot. The Doctor needs to be able to mess with people. Because no diplomat is complete without the ability to turn a person around with mere words and mere action, but without force and without threats. If a doctor, any doctor, can achieve that, can help people simply by making them see a different way, by manipulating a situation just right, they've done well, I think. Which brings me to Paul McGann. The Doctor needs to be human. Now, you might have thought, hold on. Shouldn't that technically be, the 10th reason thing that a doctor needs? Yes, it probably should. But hear me out. Paul McGann was a very human doctor, long before Tennant was. And the thing he portrayed more than anything else was that the Doctor cared. He had empathy. People he met and people he knew mattered to him. His actions mattered to him. He was very soft, and that's why he eventually had to become the War Doctor. So Paul McGann represents the fact that the Doctor needs to be just a little bit human. Number 9. Every Doctor... Number 9 is pretty simple. Pretty damn right on there. I'm going to tell you it straight to your face. You're probably going to think it's sass. No. The Doctor can never be cruel, and the Doctor can never be cowardly. In the moments where he really wants to give up, no matter what happens, a Doctor must pull through in some way. Even if what he does is insanely screwed up, insanely messed up, he has to feel bad for it. No matter what happens, the Doctor cannot be cruel, not be cowardly, because that is the promise he made. And if he is a coward, it better be for the right reasons. Number 10. The Doctor is irrevocably a hero. You might be thinking, well, isn't that more of a New Who thing? Yes, it very much so is. But even in the old Doctors, he always saved the day in some aspect. It might be just one person, it might be a whole planet, but he always saved the day. If you take that aspect out, you could still have a Doctor, but I feel like he'd get bored. I feel like he'd lose purpose. The Doctor has a purpose. He cares, and he helps, and he fixes things, and that is what he does. And he remembers. Number 11. You'd think I'd have a lot to say about this one. Like I was building up to it or something. But no, I don't, really. All I can really say is that when it comes down to it, no matter who the Doctor is, who they're portrayed by, what color they are, or their creed. The Doctor is always, always the type of person to help. And I don't just mean in a hero sense. I mean in every sense. The Doctor helps. And the Doctor has to help because he gets bored otherwise. Or she gets bored. But I think more importantly, the Doctor helps because the Doctor needs help. And that's important to know. The Doctor always needs companions. He always needs to help. He always needs to travel. He always needs to do something. Because if he doesn't, it just wouldn't be the same. Which brings me to a good man. And a little bit of a cheeky point. The Doctor needs to be helped. Because he's not perfect. She's not perfect. They're not perfect. It's not perfect. No matter when or where, the Doctor will always need someone there to keep them grounded. To keep them from going mad with power. To keep them realizing why they set out all those goddamn years ago. And number 13. Bet you were thinking I had something real special planned for that, didn't you? Or maybe you understood that I'm being very silly and this has gone on very long. But number 13. The Doctor must always be a traveler. The Doctor must always be a mad doc in a box. The Doctor must always be someone who helps people. The Doctor must always be someone who you can depend on. The Doctor must always be someone who you can rely on. Even if they tend to lie a lot. The Doctor must be a lot of things. 13 reasons couldn't nearly describe all the things that a Doctor needs. So how does Jodie Whittaker stand up to that? How does she fit into this whole shindig? Well, I'll tell you in the next part, because I did not expect this to go on as long as it did. See you guys in the next part, where we will finally delve in more into Jodie Whittaker as a Doctor. And the reason for that, I think in essence,